Good morning. Welcome into Unpaid Interns. I'm Griffin Epstein. A very exciting week here at Indiana as the Indiana Hoosiers get ready to take on the Ohio State Buckeyes next Saturday in what, well, has to be one of the biggest Indiana football games in the last 50 years. And we've got a great guest to talk about Indiana football, Big Ten football, and college sports in general. Lisa Byington, one of the great rising broadcasters in college sports, joins us today. Lisa, how you doing?
I'm good, Griffin. It's always nice to chat with you, and this is big time. I like the live stream. I like the quality of this. You got it going on.
Yeah, this is a great setup here. Really love having you on today. Well, we got to start talking about Indiana football first. It has all of Bloomington buzzing. They've had a breakout season. I know you've been around the team before. You've called a lot of Indiana football games over the years. I mean, did you see this season coming from Tom Allen and his team?
I will say this, they were so close in so many years and sometimes in a lot of games that I was fortunate to call for Indiana. And so it actually reminded me of when I was actually a local reporter at a CBS affiliate in Lansing, Michigan. And when Mark D'Antonio took the job at Michigan State, his first couple of years there, he was so close and some heartbreaking losses. And, you know, he became famous for his phrase of it's a game of inches. And that literally sometimes was the difference between Michigan State winning and losing football games. I was thinking about that comparison between Michigan State, where they were at that point, versus where Indiana was at. And I see a lot of parallels. Number one, Griffin, I see parallels between the two head coaches in terms of not necessarily personality and how they coach, but the fact that they were very clear and defined about their culture and the style of play that they were gonna play. And then of course, the natural comparison that I'm getting to and the parallel in the fact that Michigan State was so close in winning games and they had to somehow get over that hump. And now it seems like Indiana is doing exactly what Michigan State found in The Secret to Success, is closing the gap, even though the gap was about this big, but closing the gap to some of those games in particular against ranked opponents that they weren't able to do in the past. Now I can't project if Indiana is going to have that same success that Michigan State was able to get to in terms of winning Big Ten championships, in terms of being a football playoff contender during really kind of the meat of Mark D'Antonio's tenure. I can't predict if Tom Allen and Indiana are going to get to that point, but it's just really interesting to me to kind of see the parallels between the two programs.
That's a great comparison. I hadn't thought about that, but that would be quite something if Indiana football could get to the levels that we saw in the last 10 years. Of course, Michigan State, I was talking to some Michigan State reporters last week, reminded me that they had made the college football playoff. Only them and Ohio State have made it, which just kind of, you forget that Michigan State's had that level of success.
Well, you forget, yeah, because of you know, they were stumbling a little bit in the last few years, and obviously under a new regime this year, there's a lot of new and different things to adjust to. But let's not forget, Mark D'Antonio was the winningest head coach in Michigan State history, and arguably during that stretch between the end of Kirk Cousins' sort of tenure and the beginning of Connor Cook's quarterback tenure, it is going to be hard to beat that stretch of years of success for Michigan State.
Well, looking at this Indiana team this year, and obviously I mentioned it, they're taking on Ohio State this coming week, and everyone wants to know now, I mean, what do you think is the ceiling for this Hoosier team? Can they compete with Ohio State? Can they maybe make a run at a New Year's Six bowl game?
Yes to the second part of that question in terms of making a run to a New Year's Six bowl game. The jury's still out with me on how competitive they can be against Ohio State. And that's not necessarily a knock against Indiana. It's more of a compliment to who Ohio State is. And, you know, they've looked awfully impressive. You know, Ohio State obviously is a national championship contending type of program right now, and especially this year. Justin Fields is obviously one of the top candidates for the Heisman Award this year. And so by far, and you don't need me to tell you this, this is going to be by far the toughest test for Indiana, probably, you know, obviously going into this season and probably any other opponent that they're going to face the rest of the year. You know, I think the key to me is, can Indiana's defensive success keep it up in this game? can they provide the pressure against a very lethal Ohio State offense that not only I mentioned Justin Fields, but they have elite talent on the outside with their receivers. You know, maybe they try to force Ohio State to run the ball a little bit more. If there is an Achilles heel, and it's a very small Achilles heel for Ohio State, I would say maybe trying to take Justin Fields out of the run game, trying to take those outside receivers out of the mix, and maybe forcing someone like a Master Teague and anybody else in the run game for Ohio State to try to produce in that game more so than anybody else offensively.
It's going to be a very interesting game on Saturday. Wanted to ask you a couple of questions about Big Ten football in general. I know you've already been traveling across the Midwest calling different games, and I think nationally the biggest surprise in the Big Ten has been the struggles by a lot of the top teams. Penn State still doesn't have a win. Obviously, Michigan's struggling. Minnesota, which had a great season last year, not doing so well either. Why do you think these struggles from some of the premium teams in the Big Ten this season?
You know, it's hard to pinpoint. The Big Ten's been flipped upside down, right? Where you mentioned some of those teams where you wouldn't expect Penn State to still be looking for its first win. You wouldn't expect Michigan at this point to only have one win. On the flip side, you see the Indianas, the Northwesterns at the top of the standings. And so I actually love it. I love the unpredictability of the Big Ten so far this year. I mean, you just, outside of Ohio State being by far the most consistent week in and week out, it's hard to predict these games week in and week out. And Griffin, I think, maybe the inconsistencies with some of the teams that you mentioned, the Minnesotas, the Penn States, the Michigans, you never know how much, first of all, a couple of factors, you know, the offseason and the unique offseason that all these teams had to deal with, and they dealt with it in different ways. But, you know, some players might adjust better to Zoom meetings. Some players might adjust better to working out on their own, which are factors that all of these Big Ten athletes had to do in preparation for their season. It was a much shortened season. It was a disruptive preseason, right, with the starting stopping of the Big Ten season. All those factors play part, and I don't want to minimize that factor that maybe there are players and teams who adjusted to that better than some other teams did. You know, if you just look at Penn State as an example, they certainly have dealt with injuries and with the opt-outs. Micah Parsons, their top linebacker, opting out this year. The announcement of Journey Brown, their top running back, having to retire. And they've not only lost one running back, they've lost two, you know, to injuries and outside factors in that way. So, you know, that's not something that you can kind of gloss over in terms of just looking at the example that Penn State is. You know, Minnesota had the unfortunate, they had a shortened week after they lose to Michigan, and it was a close game against Michigan, but now they have the shortened week and turning it around and playing Maryland and the unfortunate circumstance in overtime where you miss an extra point, you know? So again, when I talk about game of inches, sometimes that's all it comes down to is maybe a missed extra point or a missed tackle or missed players. And I think you kind of go down the list of some of those challenges and you can check off a lot of them for the Minnesotas and the Michigans and the Penn States here this year.
Now, of course, Indiana fans know games are decided by inches. And of course, the Penn State game was decided by a literal half an inch with Michael Penix's dive at the pylon. I guess one thing that it kind of stands out for me, mentioned Northwestern as kind of being the other team that's had a great season so far, is Bill Connolly, who does a returning production of all the college football teams in the country. He had Northwestern and IU as the two most returning production of any team in the Big Ten. So I guess maybe experience maybe played a bigger factor this season than in years past, just because of a limited amount of time in fall camp or in not really having a spring camp this season.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, and you get a veteran quarterback. So this is, it's interesting. The fact that Peyton Ramsey as a veteran quarterback and a really good team guy. I mean, Griffin, I know when you're in and around the Indiana program, that's all Tom Allen could talk about. And even last year, the fact that he was losing his starting job at some points and in some games to Michael Penix, and he was still the favorite on the football team. So Pat Fitzgerald adds not only that kind of team player and that kind of locker room, inside the locker room boost But he adds a quarterback, which they really did need, and they were missing that. And that was really, when you talk about the problems that Northwestern had last year, they didn't get the consistent play at the quarterback position. So Peyton Ramsey has been a huge addition to Northwestern this year. The defensive side of the ball, they've always been consistent. Mike Hankwitz as the defensive coordinator there, you know what you're going to get with him. There's no secret. When you have the pieces like Patty Fisher, Blake Gallagher to sort of solidify and anchor that defensive side of the ball, and then you fill in on the offensive side of the ball with a new offensive coordinator, which I did think it was time. You know, Nick McCall had been there as an offensive coordinator for several years, and it was time. You know, they had shown the loyalship and the loyalty, I should say, between McCall and Fitzgerald. But sometimes, you know, they need a change and they need a fresh look. And that's certainly what they've gotten with the offensive coordinator, a new look in that way. And just with the consistency that a Peyton Ramsey now provides at the quarterback position for them this year.
Yeah, I know Indiana fans kind of hoping that maybe in that Champions Week, IU would play Northwestern and you get the rematch with Peyton Ramsey and Michael Penix to have them as the two of only three undefeated teams left in the Big Ten. It's quite something. And I guess a testament to the Indiana program and developing quarterbacks so far.
Absolutely. I love this story, and I'm sure Indiana fans have heard it, but you know, Michael Penix has got to be one of the most favorite people on campus right now, right? So it's worth retelling in the fact that when Tom Allen went down for his home visit to Florida to recruit Michael Penix, you know, he didn't just bring himself and the coordinators and some people on the offensive side of the ball. He brought the entire staff to bring in Michael Penix. And he knew at the time, you know, there are game-changing recruits that you get. And maybe once in sometimes a generation sort of recruits. We don't know if Michael Penix is going to live up to that kind of standard, but certainly a game changer. And Tom Allen knew it at the time. And I'm so glad, frankly, Griffin, that Michael Penix is healthy this year. And that's been part of the problem, right, with his career and the fluctuation between him and Peyton Ramsey and in his short Indiana career. And it's great to see a healthy Michael Penix, because I always projected in the previous years when I had done some Indiana games, man, if Penix was healthy and he's got all these pieces to work with, what we're seeing now is, I think, what everyone projected what could be for Indiana football this year.
And it's certainly all come together this season for IU football. Very exciting time in Big Ten football. We're halfway through the season. And Big Ten basketball, also right around the corner, actually starts next week somehow in this very strange 2020 schedule. And Lisa, I know you call a lot of college basketball, both men's and women's, for Big Ten Network and Fox Sports. What are you expecting this college basketball season to look like? I know a lot is still really up in the air.
Yeah, you know what, Griffin, you're catching me. Like, I'm in, like, my brain right now is in football mode. So to make it shift, I know we're going to have to make that shift, but to make that shift, I don't know if I'm quite there yet. Let me just, before I give you my thoughts about this year's season, just to put a period on last year's season and the fact that it was just so exciting. And it was so exciting to see the stories and the programs emerge, like Rutgers and Penn State, for example, have the success and so heartbreaking in a couple of ways that those programs have the success were most likely NCAA tournament teams and never got that opportunity. You know, with the season falling short, I was curious how a Cassius Winston, for instance, of Michigan State was going to perform in his final season with the Spartans. And we never got to see those final chapters evolve. And that was such a big bummer, not only for me. I know there was a lot of basketball fans across the country who were disappointed with all of that. But having said that, now we're turning the page, right? And a lot of those programs, you know, you look at the preseason rankings and about half, for the first time in conference history, half of the men's basketball teams in the Big Ten are ranked in the AP top 25. So it's exciting. I mean, to think about possibly 10 teams last year possibly making the postseason in the NCAA tournament, and then to sort of kind of bleed that into the excitement of the preseason for this year, and you hope it translates. But certainly with the preseason rankings certainly with the, some of the teams that you see that with some of the players coming back, I was excited to see Illinois so loaded as an example of players that probably could have opted out or tried to go pro who didn't. I'm a college basketball person, so the more I can see these talented athletes playing college basketball, I'm a big cheerleader for them, and I'm really excited for the college basketball season to start. But I'm not quite there yet. You know, we got about a week or so and some change left before we can get to that point.
Well, it's strange because we still don't have a schedule out yet. It's supposed right. to start next week, so it just feels very odd that to talk about it. It feels like we have to. And one thing that got some attention in Bloomington last week, the IU women's basketball team was voted to finish first for the first time in program history in the Big Ten. Both the media and the coaches know you're the top voice for Big Ten women's basketball. You've called a lot of IU women's basketball over the years. Do you think this is the year that Terry Moore and squad can break through and potentially win the Big Ten?
It could be. You know, I watched a little bit of Coach Morin's preseason, you know, press conference that they had with all the Big Ten women's coaches. And I loved her answer about the fact and how she handled with her team sort of the preseason expectations. And she said, you know, when they came out, talked about it, we celebrated it, and then we literally like crumbled up a piece of paper of the preseason rankings and we threw it out in the wastebasket, because ultimately we all know that the preseason rankings aren't going to get you to a championship. So impressed with what Indiana was able to do last year. And, you know, I talk about last year because they have so many key players coming back as well. Allie Patberg at the top of the list in terms of the Notre Dame transfer, who will be the leader for this team this year. They have a Mackenzie Holmes, who was a freshman, who contributed so much as one of the younger players. Now she has Big Ten experience under her belt as a sophomore. And, you know, they knocked off some of the best teams in the country, and maybe some of the teams like in a South Carolina, who is favored to win a national championship. So they're not afraid to play competition. They're not afraid to have the confidence to beat some of those top teams across the country. And I still think their toughest test right now, at least early, will be Maryland. And I always look forward to even last year calling those Maryland-Indiana games. But again, congrats to Terry Moore. And you talk about someone kind of like Tom Allen, who came in and established what their culture was going to be and what their style of play was going to be. She got all the pieces and the players to sort of match that. And I just kind of smiled when the preseason rankings came out, because it was good to see Indiana on top. It's fresh and new, and I just love it.
Exciting times here in IU for a lot of sports. Wanted to transition a little bit and talk a little bit about your career and certainly a unique time right now. I know you've been on site, you know, going and calling these different Big Ten football games. What's that experience been like for you, especially, you know, having no fans in the stadium?
It's been challenging. It's been different. And, you know, the Big Ten had approved in each stadium a certain decibel level, right, of sort of the fake crowd noise, which helps a little bit. But, you know, you're still calling a game with maybe 2,000 people in the stands when you're talking about the family members are the only fans that are allowed in Big Ten games this year. There's no bands, there's no cheerleaders. And so I think it's different, maybe, especially for that opening weekend. Now you kind of know what to expect. And quite frankly, Griffin, it's maybe a little bit different in the warmups. You know, it has sort of like a practice or a scrimmage feel at first, but then on that opening kick, and I do think that the added crowd noise that the Big Ten has approved, I do think that helps. As a broadcaster, you sort of, after the opening kick happens, you kind of forget that the crowd's not there. And quite frankly, I kind of like it. And I noticed this about some of the summer sports. When I say summer sports, the sports that continued on through the summer, the NBA, the WNBA, Major League Baseball, both soccer leagues, pro soccer leagues on the men's and the women's side. What I appreciated in those leagues, and actually I can see it translating now to Big Ten football, you sometimes pick up on conversations or reactions that you wouldn't normally hear over the mics because of the crowd noise. So on trying to spin it positively, sometimes that's one of the positives that you can pick up, is maybe some of the the added ambiance on the sidelines or frankly on the field that you might not normally hear because of the hundreds of thousands of people that were normally in Big Ten stadiums.
Has your preparation or routine changed at all with obviously different schedules and just different protocols at the stadium and a different, you know, type of game to call?
The one area where I think it has changed is the fact we don't have any one-on-one interaction with the teams anymore. You know, some of the schools would allow us into practices sometimes, like maybe on a Thursday practice or a Friday walkthrough. We don't have that access anymore. You know, I don't know how much your viewers understand, you know, as the broadcast network crew, what we do in terms of interacting with the coaches. Usually on Wednesdays of game week, we talk to the away team, meaning head coach and coordinator, and any sort of players they might give us. On Friday, we talk to the home coaches, the head coach and both coordinators, and again, any players that they might give us. And that stuff is done in person, especially the Friday meetings. And so now all of that is done via Zoom or sort of a video conference call setup. And so that has changed a lot. You know, there are times where I don't even see my sideline reporter in person on a football weekend. You know, I've worked with, for instance, Cooley Harvey, like the last two weekends. And this past weekend, he had to pop up because he had a question. So he popped up just real quick, stuck his head into the booth. And, you know, we all have our masks on and everything. And I said, you know, I worked with him the weekend before. And I said, Coley, I think this is the first time I've actually seen you in person, you know. So there's a divide and a tier level between the teams and the programs on who has access to who. And quite frankly, there's a divide, too, at the broadcaster and network level. You know, we're very limited in the booth in terms of how many people we have actually in the booth. You know, our stats person, our statistician is normally there standing right next to me when I'm doing play-by-play. That is now virtual. That is now remote, as an example. So I'm looking at a computer screen for stats, and I joke, you know, that's my Mr. or Miss Stats person for the game, you know. So all kinds of adjustments, like I said, with the coaches and the teams, as well as the networks and the broadcasters who bring these games to all the viewers.
Really interesting stuff. You know, it continues to be a tough time for sports broadcasters and people in sports media. And, you know, it doesn't really look like there's a return to normal coming anytime soon. What would you be your advice to both aspiring sports broadcasters and people currently in the industry to try to get through these next, you know, couple months or however long it takes to return to some semblance of normal?
Yeah, it's a really challenging time to try to look for work. You know, we all know that, and not just in the broadcasting world, but trying to sustain a living no matter what you do. So, you know, my advice for some of the younger broadcasters trying to work your way up, try to find reps any way you can. And sometimes for me, you know, when I was starting, sometimes those reps come on your couch, right? So sit on your couch, like the couch behind me, pull up a game, and this might sound a little crazy, but call the game on your couch, call it out loud, get used to your voice. Those are the only ways you can get reps. That's way better than not doing anything. And yeah, Griffin, it's a really challenging time in so many ways for so many people. And I'm fortunate. I literally walk into a football booth these days, and I try to get there early. You know, usually 3 hours or plus before kickoff. And I just have an overwhelming sense of gratitude this year for no matter what assignment I get and no matter what game I get, because I know there's a lot of talented people, for right or for wrong, who are sitting at home who don't have some of the same opportunities. And so continue to kind of hone your work. For those like me who are given the opportunity, continue to be grateful and extra grateful for the opportunity that you have, because we literally, everyone preaches, right? You never know when the next game might be your last. And literally in this crazy world of 2020, this year, that statement is more true than any other year.
Yeah, it's been a challenging time for so many people and so few games and cancellations going on. You're also one of the few female play-by-play broadcasters in the industry. How much is that a challenge and something that you're aware of?
I'm reminded of it almost every time we talk about doing play-by-play for football. And it's a question you have to ask, and I understand that, Griffin. And it's a question that I constantly get asked and constantly get reminded of. And it'll be that way, unfortunately, until there's more and more females who are given the opportunity to do football. I always say that it's my dream and my goal to have a female do a football game and to be background noise. And when I say that, kind of, you know, people don't really understand what I mean. What I mean by this is, think about how many times that you either have a football game on or a men's basketball game. It's a male voice, and maybe you're doing some other work, because that's what we do now, right? We got like second screens and third screens going on, and you're doing some extra work, and you never think twice about who the announcer is. And sometimes I'm guilty of this as well, but if you hear a female on a men's basketball game or on a football game, you're going to stop what you're doing, and you're going to try to figure out who it is, because right now it still doesn't sound quote unquote normal. You know, we've gone through decades and decades of a male voice being the narrative for a football game. And so I don't know when that's going to happen, Griffin. I don't think it's going to happen in 5 years. I don't know if it'll happen in 10 years, but somewhere down the line, it's going to become the norm. And I can't wait for the day that Joe Fan or Josephine Fan is sitting in their living room and they've got that football game on and it is background noise. It's truly background noise, no matter who's calling the game of what gender.
What do you think needs to happen for us to help get to that moment and just improve the overall diversity in the broadcast booth?
Well, yeah, there's several things. I think the people who have been given the opportunities, Beth Moens, you know, Pam Ward was before Beth Moens, who kind of paved the way for Beth Moens. Kate Scott has done some stuff with Pac-12 football. I know Tiffany Green has done some things for ESPN. Courtney Lyle has been for ESPN, been giving some opportunities, and of course myself and the Fox and the Big Ten Network world. So we are, for right or for wrong, kind of shouldering that responsibility to get to the point that it sounds normal. The other thing is that there has to be the willingness of management on their side to hire females, not just because they're hiring a female, but because they're a female who does a good job at the job, you know? So it's a little bit twofold. And those are the things I think that have to happen. And my home phone is ringing. This is the danger, right? Of doing this kind of thing live from home. So I apologize for that.
You're all good. A couple more questions for you, Lisa. You know, you've been around now Big Ten sports for a while. I was just wondering if you have a favorite story or moment while calling a game or just being around the industry that you'd want to share with our viewers.
Oh, wow. That's a great question. You know, I have a funny story that I like to share, and it was actually pre Big Ten Network. So I mentioned at the beginning of this interview that I was a local reporter in Lansing, Michigan. And one of my favorite stories I like to share is, first of all, I've enjoyed my life as a local reporter because I had to pick up the camera, shoot highlights on my shoulder, go to like three high school football games, and then come back and edit it, change my clothes, put my hair, you know, get my hair done and my makeup on. And so you're doing all kinds of roles, first of all. Well, in a rare circumstance, I actually had one of our interns who volunteered to be a photographer for me. And it was a Michigan State, Wisconsin men's basketball game. And at the time, Michigan State, I don't know if people remember this name, but Drew Neitzel was the point guard. And in a rare circumstance, it was actually one of Tom Izzo's teams that wasn't guaranteed to make the NCAA tournament. So in this game, Griffin, they're playing Wisconsin, who was ranked number one at the time under Bo Ryan. And so to get a win like this would certainly, you know, boost their NCAA resume. Michigan State knocks off Wisconsin. The fans go nuts. The Izzone is storming the field, or the court, I should say. I'm still in football mode. And my intern, his name's Chad. And we're walking around by the tunnel and the crowd, it's just a mob, it's chaos. And we see Izzo coming towards us. And he looks at me and so we connect. And I said, Chad, start rolling. You know, I'm going to try to get like an on-court reaction from Izzo. And instead of just waiting for, you know, kind of the mundane podium stuff. So he walks up to me and I ask my two questions and he's crying, you know, he's really emotional. And I'm just sitting there, he's giving us great answers and he walks away. And I turn, you know, like, cause my intern's behind me, Chad's behind me with the camera. And I turn cause I hadn't seen him. And I said, wasn't that great? And the camera lens, which is supposed to be, you know, like this, was hanging like this. So Chad didn't have the heart to stop me in the middle of the interview, but in the chaos of all the students, you know, rushing the field and everything, they had broken our camera. And I Izzo was crying and I just wanted to cry. You know, he had walked away and there was nothing that I could do. But I still kind of remember that moment. And though I wanted to cry at the time, I can laugh about it and smile about it now.
Well, that's a good story. I could feel something either wasn't recording or the camera was out of frame or something was going to go wrong. Cause sometimes that's just the way it goes.
Right. So, I think Chad did the right thing, you know, in not stopping me, but, you know, it's like I said, it's something that it's a good story. We can laugh about it later. All that technical stuff sometimes happens, right? You just got to roll with it in TV.
Technology can be a fickle thing sometimes. That's for certain. One more question for you, Lisa. You know, college sports are changing. We're seeing new rules, new schedules. What are the changes that you envision in the sports media industry and the college sports industry going forward that we should be looking out for over the next year and, you know, going forward over the next 10 years?
I've wondered about that. You know, a lot of games these days, you know, you mentioned that we're actually, as announcers, we're on site for some of these Big Ten football games. That's not necessarily the case. Now, you know, I look at some of my friends across the country who are literally calling a college football game from home. And we always joke as announcers that, you know, oh, it would be great to just call this game on your couch. In fact, I told people who are trying to get in the business, get your reps by calling the game on the couch. And now literally we have professional announcers who are getting paid to call games on their couch or in their den or in their study or in their office. And every time I see a picture of that setup, I'm amazed. But I just wonder, you know, is that the sign of the times? It's always so valuable to be there on site, but networks across the board and across the country are saddled with a lot of budget concerns. And so are we going to get to the point now where more announcers are going to be calling games off of a monitor, maybe not just at their house, but, you know, maybe at the network studio where they're calling a game off the monitor? You know, Big Ten Network was one of the first to do that. And they definitely have that capability and that setup to do it. So you just wonder how much of the games in terms of the calling aspect, the production aspect, are actually going to be on site. You know, hopefully we can turn the corner of the coronavirus pandemic that we're in right now. But I wonder, you know, when we turn the corner, what our world, our broadcasting world, is going to look like from here on out.
Oh, we have to wait and see. Lisa, we really appreciate you coming on today. Great stories, great insight. Really enjoyed these last 30 minutes.
Well, I've enjoyed it too, Griffin. And I'm just going to give you a plug right now and for anybody else who's watching, in the fact that we talk about students and up-and-comers and broadcasters who are dreamers to be in the business. And I salute you because this business is a networking business. And you... took the time to introduce yourself to me when I was doing an Indiana football game. And, you know, I invited you to go up to the booth, and we don't have that capability all the time with everyone, but for that game and for that day, it made sense. And I just applaud you for wanting to do it, for reaching out to the Big Ten Network, for doing all the grunt jobs, right, to get yourself sort of inundated with not only the announcer side of things, but the production side of things, the things that a lot of people don't see that go on behind the scenes. And so it's about doing the grunt jobs. It's about trying to take advantage of your opportunities. And it's reaching out in the right way and networking to people who are already in the business in the right way. And you check all those boxes, Griffin. And so I applaud you for the work that you've done up to this point. And I can't wait to see where you go in this business.
I really appreciate that, Lisa, and appreciate all the the advice that you've helped with me looking at my reels and obviously getting to go in the booth and listen to you and Jay Lehman call a Rutgers game live on national TV was a really, really awesome experience I'll never forget. So a big thanks for you for everything over the last year.
It's a unique experience to watch Jay call a football game, isn't it?
I mean, just to watch, I had never, you know, actually been in a booth on a national TV broadcast and to see everything that goes into it from the statistician to the people behind the scenes in the truck. It was just a really awesome experience and great insight into how the whole industry works.
And if I remember right, I think maybe the game that you were at, you know, Jay and I did our open and then something happened. We turned to, you know, we have our backs to the field, right? And so we're mm-hmm. facing the camera for our open. And then when we go off camera, we turn around to face the field to call the game. And didn't we almost lose a monitor or something?
It was. I feel like someone knocked over a monitor or something fell, something like that. It was not a great game, so it felt like, you know, I guess then maybe things were going to go wrong. But it was just awesome to see everything come together to put together a big broadcast, and that, you know, you only hear and see the two or three people on camera, but you know, it's a 20-25 people production. And I had to get there at 6 a.m. I mean, the people worked so long and hard, and you had to leave right after the game to go flying. So it's amazing to see how hard you work and all the different things you do as well. It's a great motivator for me to keep on working. So it was an awesome experience, one I'll definitely never forget.
Well, good. And I'm glad you took advantage of it. And thank you for having me on, Griffin. I enjoyed it.
Yeah, so it was an absolute blast. All right, that will do it today for our episode of Unpaid Interns. We'll be back on Wednesday. We're going to be talking some Pac-12 football, given by my folks back home on the West Coast a little bit of love. Pac-12 honestly might be one of the deepest conferences in college football, so we'll be back on Wednesday for that. Until then, you can check out all of our Unpaid Interns episodes on our IU Sports Media YouTube page or wherever you get your podcasts if you want to listen in audio form. That'll do it today for our episode of Unpaid Interns. For Lisa Byington, I'm Griffin Epstein. We'll talk to you again real soon.